Hello, I'm Stephanie Hawkinson. This is Rice Street in Wellesley, Massachusetts. It's a residential street much like others in the town, with one big difference. In 1936, the leaders of the town chose it as the site of a new high school. This building, designed by a previously unknown architect who lived in Wellesley, was destined to become architecturally significant in New England and receive national accolades. The reason for choosing this site is simple: location, location, location. Up the street behind me is Washington Street, the main east-west thoroughfare of the town. Just east of here is a major town center, Wellesley Hills. To the west, less than a mile, are the Town Hall, the Free Library, and Wellesley Square. And in 1936, the high school football field was already located where it now is. Most importantly, Rice Street led to a wooded area of townland that was called Honeywell Park. And in Honeywell Park, there was a hill, really just a little rise in the land. But with enough skill and ingenuity, you could fit a school building on it. There were two high school buildings in Wellesley before this one. The first one, on Washington Street, is still standing. It's been used for various purposes over the years and was converted to apartments in the 1980s. The second one was named Gamaliel Bradford High School, after a famous author who lived in Wellesley and served as chairman of the school committee. It was located on Kingsbury Street. That site is now occupied by the Wellesley Middle School. The town of Wellesley grew rapidly as a residential community during the 19-teens and the 1920s. By the early 1930s, it was clear that the student population of Wellesley was about to outgrow the existing high school. The town held a design competition to select the architect for a new one. Four firms competed, and the winner was Perry, Shaw, and Hepburn of Boston, a firm previously best known for the restoration of colonial Williamsburg, Virginia. The designer for the project, Robert C. Dean, was a graduate of MIT's Department of Architecture and lived in Wellesley. Robert Dean was only 33 years old at the time, and he wasn't yet a partner of his firm. What he was a student of every type of architecture, from the most traditional New England style to the most contemporary buildings in Europe. Robert Dean knew that virtually every high school in Massachusetts was designed in what's called the Georgian style, a long brick building with small windows, a central entrance, and a cupola on top.
Instead, Robert Dean chose to design the first non-Georgian high school in Massachusetts. He used ideas from as near as the neighborhoods of Wellesley and from as far away as the American Southwest and Stockholm, Sweden. He created a building that was unprecedented in New England school architecture. The new high school would have the same name as the old one, Gamaliel Bradford High School. But in 1961, the name was changed, and Gamaliel Bradford High School became Wellesley High School.
The building is shaped like an L, with the monumental tower at the focal point of the L, the auditorium wing extending to the north, and the classroom wing to the west. This shape, which was unconventional for a school building in the 1930s, was actually dictated by the shape of the small hill on which the school was built. Robert Dean, the architect, took what might have been a limitation and turned it into an inspiration. Look how he designed the two arms of the L. Those strong rectangular masses, in the most contemporary style of his time, project out with powerful horizontal lines. The landscape circular driveway from Rice Street complements the building forms with a softer foreground. There are other vehicle entrances, from Payne Street on the north side and Seaver Street to the southeast, but they were much changed by building additions in later years. This front entrance remains much as it was designed by Robert Dean and by the landscape architect Robert Washburn Beale. Like the rest of the 1938 building, it is clad in red brick laid in the Flemish bond pattern. The water table, belt courses, most of the entry and window surrounds, and the caps on the brick balustrades of the stairways are in contrasting material, Indiana limestone. Most sections of the limestone cornice are capped with flashing. Here, as elsewhere in the building, the flat roof was originally tar and gravel over hard pine, tongue and groove planking. The tar and gravel was replaced later by a rubber membrane. A united window design connects all three floors in each bay, making a strong vertical counterpoint to this section's long horizontal shape. Robert Dean gave the credit for this window design to a partner in his firm, Andrew Hopewell Hepburn. The window units reflect a 1930s machine age aesthetic with other elements added. Each steel casement window includes muntins dividing small rectangular panes with four pane sections that swing out to open. Robert Dean said that the school's brick walls and the small window panes were adapted from residential architecture in Wellesley so that this modern building would still, quote, seem familiar to pupils, teachers, and citizens, end quote. The louvered unit ventilators between floors are made of copper. On the spandrels below the windows, there are designs that are apparently inspired by Southwestern Native American art. In a 1938 booklet written for the school's dedication, they are called, quote, primitive symbols for the sun, lightning, and clouds, suggesting the forces of nature the building must withstand, end quote. They are cast in metal. The blueprints called for brass, but Robert Dean wrote later that they were done in cast iron. The auditorium wing forms the short side of the L. It is three stories on a raised basement, and it originally had a stepped front profile. In 1955, expansion of the third floor cafeteria eliminated the step back and substituted the strong front of tall, small-paned windows that is there now. The enclosed entry block is five bays across. The entries are in the three middle bays, flanked by two round windows, which echo the round governmental seals over the entries. The seals, done in carved stone with bronze lettering and ornament, represent the United States of America, the Commonwealth of Massachusetts, and the town of Wellesley. The four light fixtures are in the form of a scroll against a plaque with a protective grille. The glass lens of each light is a ridged Fresnel lens, similar to that of a lighthouse. Along with the round, porthole-style windows, these lights remind us of New England's maritime heritage. Generations of Wellesley High School students have sat in this window just like this. The side and rear elevations of the auditorium still look much as they did when built. There is only one window bay in the northwest side, but it has a distinctive feature. The limestone surround of the window contains the only classical style ornaments on the building's exterior, a stylized egg and dart molding under the sill and dentil molding at the top. In the stair landing below this window, the brick balustrade is pierced by a limestone W for Wellesley. According to the 1938 booklet, the auditorium was oriented at right angles to the classroom block, quote, to avoid undue lengthening of the structure and to make it readily accessible to the public as well as to the students, end quote. And as we've seen, this orientation also guides the eye to the school's most monumental feature, the tower. During the decades after he designed it, Robert Dean would say only that the tower was to denote the public function of the school and to help people locate the school from a distance. But observers of modern architecture immediately noticed the resemblance between this tower and a modern European landmark, the Town Hall of Stockholm, Sweden. Years later, Robert Dean acknowledged that this building, quote, was much in our minds when we were designing, end quote. Here was clear evidence that the architect wanted to make a clean break with New England school architecture. In fact, although many town residents still call the top of the tower a cupola, Robert Dean never did. He only called it, quote, the upper portion of the tower, end quote. The brick base of the tower is one bay across and three bays deep. Its vertical rise of five stories is emphasized by the vertical window treatment, culminating in a clock face 7.5 feet in diameter. The building's cornerstone is at the tower's western corner, now obscured by shrubs. Over the years, town residents have speculated that artifacts and memorabilia of the 1930s might be enclosed in the cornerstone. But according to minutes of the school committee from that time, the option of putting items in the cornerstone was considered and rejected. The upper portion of the tower rises an additional 39 feet to the bottom of the weather vane. It's constructed of wood on a steel frame covered with lead-coated copper, which gives it a soft gray color. The lower part is on a square footprint, and it's decorated with applied copper molding in a zigzag pattern, which can be interpreted as a typical Art Deco design, or a W for Wellesley, or both. In the circular upper part, columns support a convex roof. Lead-coated copper rails are reinforced with steel. The copper balusters were originally highlighted with gold leaf. Above the roof is a copper ball, 3 feet 4 inches in diameter, covered in gold leaf and topped with a weather vane. Robert Dean said he chose the spread eagle, quote, to symbolize the soaring of youth's ambition. He also said he designed it, quote, just for fun. The eagle is made of sheet metal and copper and covered with a lead-coated copper. According to some accounts, the eagle was originally 3 feet higher than it is now, but the pole was shortened after it bent during the hurricane of 1938. At the south end of the classroom block is the gymnasium, a two-story wing on a raised basement. For noise reasons, the gymnasium is separated from the classrooms by a one-story connector. Like the auditorium, it is positioned to allow public access without opening up the rest of the building. It is approximately 5 bays across and 8 bays deep, and has windows on all 4 sides. Although the windows use the same steel sash as elsewhere in the building, they have a more utilitarian appearance, with brick surrounds and limestone sills. On the southwest side, however, a continuous stone surround with incised ornaments adds architectural interest to this bank of 6 windows. These original light fixtures, which look like an auto headlight with a protective grille, can still be seen at locations on or near the gymnasium. On the southwest wall, between the exterior doors, telescoping wood bleachers can be pulled out to provide seating along one side of the basketball court. Through a missing panel, one can see older-style perforated acoustic tiles affixed to the roof. Originally, a folding partition wall was used to divide this room into separate spaces for boys and girls.
Although no longer used, the partition is still stored in its floor-to-ceiling cabinet along the northeast wall.
On either side of the cabinet, a ceramic brick recess contains a drinking fountain and a cuspidor. Although the drinking fountains are later replacements, the cuspidors are original. Still more of the maple wood flooring was applied in a vertical orientation to the walls of the boys' and girls' restrooms. Although the boys' room was later used for storage, some of the maple wall covering can still be seen. Separate doors on this interior wall lead into the stair hall and the corresponding locker rooms for boys and girls.
The interior of the gymnasium looks much as it did when the building opened in 1938, with the addition of some championship banners, of course.
Glass block, which became a hallmark of modern architecture in the 1940s, had one of its earliest uses here. The architect used it to distribute natural light in ground-level corridors and locker rooms near the gymnasium. Here, glass block over a doorway brings light from a naturally lit stairway into the corridor. You could call it a bank shot of natural lighting. The slightly dropped acoustic ceiling probably dates from a renovation in the 1990s. Another section that was set apart for sound isolation is the music wing. Of all the components of the 1938 building, this one has been altered the most in its massing and external appearance. It was originally 1 story on a raised basement. The 1938 building is framed with brick exterior piers and reinforced concrete on the interior. Steel I-beams were used for the wide ceilings of the auditorium and the gymnasium, and also for the upper portion of the tower. Designed for a capacity of 750 students, the 1938 building contained 70 rooms. 28 of these were instructional rooms, such as classrooms and laboratories. 21 were for other student uses, and another 21 were support rooms, such as the kitchen and boiler room. The windows of the classroom block were spaced every 14 feet, setting up 14-foot units of space inside the building. 3 units for a laboratory, 2 units for a classroom, 1 unit for a conference room. To facilitate this, utilities such as electrical and heating were located only in the exterior or hallway walls, not in the walls between rooms. In general, the interior partitions are constructed of gypsum block or terracotta tile, then covered in plaster. The corridors of the classroom block are finished in iron spot brick, which has a glazed surface and dark spots of iron oxide. It was chosen for both its distinctive appearance and for maximum durability. The rounded corners at all of the openings are a character-defining feature. They are found not only at doorways, but in the unusual niches for lockers and fire extinguishers. At the doorways, one can see that the wall between the classrooms and the corridor is nearly 3 feet thick, 32 inches to be exact. That's a result of recessing the lockers on one side of the wall and the classroom cabinets on the other. This unusual feature helped to insulate the classrooms from noise in the hallway. This classroom, room 209, has been used by the English department and is located near the library. It retains its original brown ash closets, shelving, and cabinetry. The tall windows, which are now partially blocked by a later dropped ceiling, have splayed openings to let in as much natural light as possible. Their slate sills were called stools in the original blueprints. Wood features are even more prominent in the original library space, which is now divided into two classrooms and part of a third, respectively rooms 212, 210, and 208. In keeping with its place as the educational heart of the school, the library was located on the second floor directly across from the central stairwell. Its wood decoration included these tall panels in the window openings.
We're standing in the classroom where American poet Sylvia Plath was a student. This was an English class taught by the legendary Wellesley High School teacher Wilbury Crockett.
At its western end, the third floor corridor is lit by this tall window, which was decorated with an ornate decal. The stair halls emphasize the building's distinctive use of iron spot brick and round windows. The angled corners round off the space and guide traffic flow around the stair landings.
The auditorium wing originally contained three spaces: the lobby, just inside these doors, behind that the auditorium, which is two stories high, and the third floor, which originally housed a cafeteria and also was used as a study hall.
When the building was renovated in 1992, many changes were made to this area, but some original features survive, such as the walls of iron spot brick, the bronze radiator grills, and the wood doors with raised panels that lead into the auditorium. According to the blueprints for this wing, the exterior doors of this lobby were paneled wood doors like these, but with glazing to let in natural light. Under its present coat of paint, the lobby's baseboard is the original bluestone material. The lobby floor was described in the plans as flagstone. The surface we see now is probably the original. The lobby is not exactly rectangular. Instead, like the stairwells, it has angled corners that gently encourage the flow of people into the auditorium. When this building opened in 1938, the auditorium had a seating capacity of 800, including the balcony. Subsequent renovations have reduced its capacity, added acoustic ceiling tiles, extended the stage into the room, and made other changes. However, the auditorium retains some of its original features. The proscenium arch over the stage still has its 1930s modern profile. Although the orchestra pit was replaced with a stage extension, the stairs that flank the stage with their slate treads and risers appear to be in their original position under the arch. The walls are plaster, and the dado, or lower wall covering, is in polished slate. The names of famous Americans are inscribed on the side walls in gold leaf letters. The original flooring in the aisles was cork, which probably does not survive under the present carpeting.
This lobby is the entrance to not only the auditorium, but to the entire school.
Originally, the school cafeteria and kitchen were located on the third floor of this wing to take advantage of the elevated views and to vent away food odors. After several renovations, no interior finishes from the 1938 construction survive on this floor, except for this small area of floor tile in what was apparently a kitchen alcove.
This dumbwaiter and another one just like it brought supplies up from the basement storeroom to the third floor kitchen.
To increase floor space in the cafeteria, the step back northeast and southwest walls were removed, and new walls were built with tall windows in the wall plane of the auditorium below. When a new cafeteria was built adjoining the original building, this third floor space was converted to classrooms. Supporting beams in the classroom space indicate the original location of the third floor wall. On its first three floors, the tower's interior is part of the classroom block. It has only two distinct rooms, on the fourth and fifth floors. The walls of the tower rooms and stair hall are whitewashed brick. The larger room on the fourth floor is probably one the architects thought would be used for student activities. In later years, it was used mainly for storage, probably because it is accessible only by a winding staircase with 26 steps. Steel framing, like that used in the auditorium and gymnasium ceilings, is visible here at close range. The northwest-facing window gives a fine view of the Honeywell playing fields. The fifth floor space, accessible by a ladder, contains the mechanism for the exterior tower clock and a scuttle leading to the upper portion of the tower.
Mm-hmm.
A great building is created when the genius of an architect combines disparate design elements into something new. That's what Robert Dean did. Can we give a name to this architectural style? There are numerous terms from that time between World War I and World War II. Colonial Revival, Art Deco, Bauhaus, and International styles, just to name a few. Dean drew on many of them, and in turn, architects who followed him drew on his work. Many of his designs are linked to the early development of what we now call modernism. The Pulitzer Prize-winning architectural critic Robert Campbell describes Robert Dean as big in the architectural field of his day. The names of architectural styles come and go with a perspective of time. For now, it is enough simply to enjoy and respect an innovatively designed building that functioned well for its intended purpose. Although Robert Dean was familiar with the Georgian style of colonial Williamsburg, he was proud that he did not design just one more neo-Georgian school building for Wellesley. But almost in spite of itself, his non-traditional design expresses a Georgian sense of balance.
There are so many ideas at work in this building. Classical proportions and modern energy, the comforts of home and monumental aspirations, a New England identity that also embraces the world, and a bird on the pole just for fun.
Mm-hmm.